be God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's pray together. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us. Let us pray. Lord of all power and might, the author and giver of all good things, graft into our hearts the love of your name. Increase in us true religion, nourish us with all goodness, and bring forth in us the fruit of good works. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. Oh.
to God.
Our psalm today is Psalm 69. We'll be reading verses 1 through 18, and we'll read each half verse responsively. Save me, O God, for the waters have come up even to my neck. I sing down in the deep mire where there is no ground. I have come into deep waters so that the floods run over me. I am weary of crying, my throat is dry. My sight fails me from waiting so long for my God. Those who hate me without a cause are more than the hairs of my head. Those who are my enemies and would destroy me wrongfully are mighty. They bid me restore things I never took. O God, you know my foolishness, and my faults are not hidden from you. Let not those who trust in you, O Lord God of hosts, be ashamed because of me. Let not those who seek you be confounded through me, O God of Israel. Surely for your sake I have suffered reproach. Shame has covered my face. I have become a stranger to my brethren, unknown to my mother's children. Because zeal for your house has consumed me, and the reproaches of those who reproached you have fallen upon me. I wept and humbled myself with fasting, but that was turned to my reproach. I put on a sackcloth also, and I became a byword among them. Those who sit in the gates speak against me, and the drunkards make songs about me. But Lord, I make my prayer to you in an acceptable time. Hear me, O God, in the multitude of your mercy, even in the truth of your salvation. Take me out of the mire, lest I sink. O let me be delivered from those who hate me and out of the deep waters. Let not the flood waters drown me, nor let the deep swallow me up, and let not the pit shut its mouth upon me. Hear me, O Lord, for your loving kindness is good. Turn to me according to the multitude of your mercies, and hide not your face from your servant, for I am in trouble. O hasten and hear me. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
So that by the one man's obedience, the many
This is the word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to St. Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
And Lord, may your word ever be upon our minds, upon our lips, and deep within our hearts. Jesus said, "Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of the wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to courts and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake, to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will deliver brother over to death, and father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecuted you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher, and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? So have no fear of them. For nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs of your head are numbered. Fear not, therefore. You are of more value than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will deny before my Father who is in heaven." The Gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
Please be seated. I'm going to pray for you as you preach. All right. Heavenly Father, we lift up our sister Jill as she brings the word. May your word for us be upon her lips. Use her as you see fit to mold us into the men and women you have deemed us to be. Send your spirit as a hammer to break rocks, to break the hardness of our hearts away, that we might receive your word. All this we pray in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Chaplain Ed. Okay, so first off, I'd like to say that despite being exposed to COVID, I am still remaining negative. However, I am going to muzzle myself for the rest of the day in an abundance of caution because I love each and every one of you. So I was going to start with an opening prayer, but nothing gets any better than what you did. So we will launch in. So first, I wish to thank Father Michael for the opportunity, encouragement, assistance, and immense privilege of delivering this, my first sermon. Today's lectionary readings have the rather grim message of persecution. The Apostle Paul, whose feast day, along with Peter's, will be celebrated on the 29th of June, was quite intimate with the subject of persecution, as he was both a persecutor before his conversion on the road to Damascus, and was persecuted as he took the gospel out into this most fallen and broken world. When he embraced his calling, he did not stray off the path. Rather, Paul looked to the Bible as his lifelong roadmap. The Reformation fathers took up the banner that Scripture is first, and it is this banner that the Anglican Church still operates under today. This is the focus of the sermon. Matthew, whose words we read today, captures Jesus' message on persecution. Jesus did not intend to frighten us, but to encourage us that no matter what quarter persecution comes from, we have the power of God through the working of the Holy Spirit in us to rely on. This is of great hope to any Christian who navigates the fallen world in whatever age. Jesus spoke of his followers being sent out as sheep in the midst of wolves, which is a metaphor for the saved versus the unsaved, those clothed in light versus darkness, the presumed weak versus strong, or servants of God versus servants of Satan. This understanding of wolf, however, is only partially true, which leads me to believe that bona fide sheep can unintentionally develop wolf-like traits as lives are lived in this fallen world. Traits that are detrimental to the great commission of going out into the world to spread the good news. It is true that Jesus ministered to the lost and broken, but his most vocal and strongest opposition was directed against the Jewish religious elite within the church, who would block out these unclean them. Church history is replete with episodes of strife, both inside and outside the church. There can be no argument about diligently correcting practices, thoughts, beliefs, or traditions that are clearly non-biblical and threaten to turn Christ's bride, the church, to the ways of the world. Yet, there is no life or growth in a church that bars the door in fear that leaven will get in the church and ruin it. So what is the balance? Jesus calls his sheep to be wise as serpents. Today's age contains news about worldwide events that is simply a mouse click away, 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. The news is rarely good, as this world is always fallen. This deluge of bad news provokes the spirit of outrage, and the inescapable focus on all topics of evil leads to ineffectiveness.
No one person can possibly embrace, let alone try, to do something about it all. So what can his wise sheep do? Last week's lectionary readings explained how Jesus sent out his 12 disciples to go and minister specifically to the Jews. Mark noted that Jesus sent these apostles two by two. In pairs, he sent them. This is curious, as conventional wisdom would state that more ground could be covered and more people reached if each apostle went out separately. So why did Jesus send them in pairs? Perhaps because each of the pair could encourage and strengthen the other. Perhaps it was merely to share the burden. The Bible records the answer that God always does his strongest work when two or more are gathered together in his name. Jesus also gave precise tasks to these 12. They were to go only to the Jews. Why would Jesus limit them in this way? Because at that point, going into the whole world was too much. Jesus also limited the task to proclaim the kingdom of heaven is at hand, to heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, and cast out the demons. Jesus did not ask the 12 to rid the world of all evils for the same reason he sent them out in pairs, because the task for one is too great. Today's reading contains the key component of the sending out of the apostles. Knowing that his sheep would be persecuted, Jesus told the 12 in Matthew 10:20, "For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you." Jesus knows well it is easy and natural for man to try to do things by himself under his own power. And this attitude leads to failure. So how does today's wise sheep use this blueprint laid out by Jesus to do effective ministry? It is to simply, humbly, yet profoundly ask for the Holy Spirit's direction with the expectation that he will gather like-minded people together to take on one of the many tasks needed to carry out the Great Commission. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So, who is this them? To the Pharisees, it was only those under the law of Moses, the ritually clean, the Jews. To the Roman Catholics, at one time, it was only to those baptized as Roman Catholics. For us, it is only those who we feel will not taint or potentially destroy our denomination. Is that true? Paul would emphatically say, by no means. Them is every person made in the image of God. It's all of us. Jesus also defined the two greatest commandments as, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. The neighbor, the tax collector, adulterer, murderer, prostitute, leper. These are the them from days of old. Today, the them, our neighbors, could be the corrupt politician, atheist, antagonistic media blogger, opposite political party member, people who identify as LGBTQ+, or persecutors. That's who's in this current age. This is where a pure sheep, and not one who has inadvertently acquired the wolf-like qualities of fear, bias, or own agenda, is needed. Although the Bible doesn't have a lot of evidence of the apostles slipping up after Jesus' resurrection, because they were men in a fallen world, it did occur. I am reminded of Paul calling out Peter for hypocrisy after Peter would no longer eat with the Gentiles. Today's sheep can slip into error too, sometimes by barring the very church doors from those who are not like one of the church. These others, them. The sheep need to always be mindful that in the fallen world, there are sheep who have become wolf-like in their midst. Then recognize and correct them. The sheep follow where Jesus, the good shepherd, leads. Jesus met with the righteous, the sinners, and the undesirables. Some were in the synagogues. Most were not. Today's thems are also mostly not within the walls of the church, yet they are eligible to meet alongside Christ's body of believers and should be encouraged to do so. Will wolves come prowling through our doors? Undoubtedly. Should the sheep be afraid? No. History records that Christian denominations since the founding of the church can fall prey to false doctrine. Paul wrote his letters to the Galatians addressing this very subject as the Judaizers came insisting the new Gentile believers had to be circumcised. After Paul founded the church, it did not speak of this practice as a necessity. Throughout the ages, to ensure sound biblical practices, councils have met, creeds have been developed, and an entire reformation of the church took place in an effort to zealously guard true biblical doctrine. Today, communion between GAFCON and the Church of England is broken, as the Church of England is pandering to the ways of the world instead of following the path of God. Yet in all of these cases throughout the ages, the point is not to denounce those under sin and error in an acrimonious and unforgiving way while painting every single member in those bodies of believers in the bright scarlet paint of heresy. Rather, it is to point out the error, to bring repentance, and to come alongside the true, faithful believers to bolster their resolve. To accomplish this means gentle wooing, not forceful compliance. To keep church communities not in error from straying, church members must diligently, yet lovingly and respectfully, ensure practices fall in line with Scripture. By keeping an eye on Scripture, the wolves can be neutralized and either have a heart change, which means being saved through Christ or brought back into alignment with Scripture, or they can be sent away back into the sinful world. The sheep need to open the sheepfold to every them, trusting that the all-powerful God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit will safeguard the flock. What is the fruit of this calling? It is to have a vast number of believers working together under the authority of Scripture to bring new believers into the fold. These new believers are then cherished, nurtured, and developed into mature Christians so the cycle can be repeated. Make no mistake, this is the mission of our diocese, to reach out to the hurting world and to strengthen the people of God. The task is not scary and should not cause dismay. For although we, as God's emissaries, may be unschooled and ordinary, when we are weak, He is strong. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Sisters, please stand. And in response to the word, let us confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is visible and invisible. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and life of the world to come. Amen. Please sit or kneel for the prayers of the people.
Let us pray for the church and for the world, saying, hear our prayer. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being and unity of the people of God. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For Foley Beach, our Archbishop, and his wife, Allison, Ken Ross, our Bishop, and his wife, Sally, Father Michael, our pastor, and his wife, Heather Beth, Chaplain Ed, and his wife, Mariah, Marge, our deacon, and for all the clergy and people of our diocese and congregation, that we may, by our lives and doctrines, set forth God's true and lively word. Today we pray for our sister church, Anglican Church of the Resurrection in Casper, their pastor Shane Carr and his wife Heather. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others, that they may remain undaunted in their tasks. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for all our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted for their faith, especially in Turkey, that they may be strengthened in their will to follow you as the kingdom of God is advanced. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our nation, for those in authority, and for all in public service, especially the president, the vice president, the governor of the state of Wyoming, and the mayor of Cheyenne, that they may execute the duties of their office in safety and wisdom with their eyes firmly fixed on you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity, especially for healing, Father Michael, Heather Beth, Carol, Janelle, Pat Francis, Barbara, who is recovering from heart surgery, Karen Venzel, Marge, and Carrie. For comfort, wisdom, strength, and fellowship, Lucille, Chrissy, Joey, and Lily, and Joel and Maureen. We pray for the needs of the members of the congregation not here with us today, and that all members are delivered from hardness of heart to show forth your glory in all that we do. For those who do not yet believe and for those who have lost their faith, please lead them back to your loving embrace that they may receive the truth of the gospel. For those in harm's way, either natural or man-made, that they may find respite and restoration. Are there others that the congregation wishes to pray for? Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who have departed this life in the certain hope of the resurrection, in thanksgiving let us pray. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we thank you for the men and women in public service who keep us safe and secure, our freedom to worship you. Being part of the family of GAFCON, the Anglican Church in North America, and the Diocese of the Rocky Mountains, for those called to missionary work, especially abroad. Are there other words of thanksgiving where God met your needs this past week? Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Friends, I invite those who are able to kneel. And let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, who in his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to him. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. If anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Christ Jesus the righteous. He is the propitiation of our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. Friends, the peace of the Lord be always with you. Now greet one another with a sign of peace. Thank you. Kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. All things come from you, O Lord.
And of your own have we given you.
Give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and gave and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself, and when we had sinned against you, and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. And as our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. On the night that he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of the faith. Celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. And we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Alleluia. Let us pray. We do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose character ought always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. Gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. A couple words. We have wine in this cup, grape juice for those who don't drink wine. My daughter back there. And we have individual cups with both grape juice and wine. We also have gluten-free option as well for those who need that. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work that you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit be honor and glory now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for announcements. We have it.
As you are probably well aware, we had our annual rummage and bake sale yesterday, and we had a fine day. Diane's going to give you all the particulars of the money, but I just want to thank all those who participated, especially Karen and Becky, who were there all day, every day. And then next to that, we had Sue Hume and Heather Beth. And then there were others who came and gave us a lot of time, too. The Johnson family. I can't remember all the names, and I hope I'm not going to forget anybody because I don't want to slight anyone. Mariah and Abigail. It was wonderful, the help that we, those of you who came to help us. We couldn't have done it without you. We still have remnants downstairs, the things that did not sell. So after church, during hospitality hour, you're welcome to browse about, and if you see anything you can't live without, we invite you to take it. The less we have, that means the less we have to haul off. So please help yourselves. You may have it for free, or you may make a goodwill offering, whatever works well for you. We are going to, after that, pack up everything into boxes, so anyone who can stay and help us do that. As you know, many hands make light work, so we would welcome your help. So everything will be packed into boxes to be hauled off, and we're going to take it to a charity. And we're going to do that on Tuesday morning, so come at, well, shall we say, the ambitious, well, if they open at 8:30, do we want to come here at 8:30? So let's meet here at 8:30 on Tuesday, and we'll haul the boxes out to vehicles and take them to the charity. We're still going to have coffee hour. It's going to be a little bit different because we have so many things strewn about, but it'll be up front. We still have goodies, so come for refreshments. I also want to, I had too much to say today. I had to make some notes. The other thing I want to mention is that July 4th is right around the corner, so we will have our traditional fireworks viewing gathering. Come to the church at 8 o'clock. It's Tuesday, July 4th, and we're going to just bring snacks and beverages. If you want chairs, you can bring some of those, or if you want to haul the folding chairs up from the basement and take them back down, you may do that. But 8 o'clock on the 4th, and the fireworks usually start around 9 or 9:30. So we'll have some time to visit and snack first. But come, it's a nice time to get together, and we've got a great spot for viewing. Have I forgotten anything? Yes, if you brought anything for the rummage sale that you want back, be sure you snap it up before somebody else does. Okay. Okay. Anything else?
Okay. We did fairly well. We ended up with $2,262.57. So thank you to everybody.
All right, can you all hear me through this mask? Yep, all right. So this is a reminder that this Tuesday at 6:30 in the gathering room downstairs will be the prayer shawl ministry. So even if you don't knit or crochet or weave or anything like that and you just want to hang out with the cool kids, you are welcome to do that. All right, we also have the Kamiya shelter. So the fourth Tuesday of the month at 5:30, some of us meet at the Kamiya shelter to serve dinner to whoever might want it. So if you're interested in doing that, it is really wonderful ministry. Please get a hold of Becky. Finally, to add to the chaos of what is downstairs, I did bring in eggs. So if you're in need of a dozen eggs, go down and snap them up because I don't want to take them home with me. Okay, do you have some?
Thank you very much. I just was so honored to work with so many people yesterday. Everybody works so hard, but there always has to be a PIC or a clerk of the works. Where'd she go? She's up there. Oh, Diane. I don't think any of us have any idea how much work she does. And I won't tell anybody that she confessed to me that she stayed up until 1 o'clock one morning. So she does so much work. Kudos and thank you.
And I want to say a warm hello to Dan and his wife Sharon, who have come to visit us all the way from Texas. So welcome back.
Well, please stand as we cast our cares and problems on our Lord. All our problems, we send to the cross of Christ. All our sins, we send to the cross of Christ. All our divisions, we send to the cross of Christ. All the devil's works, we send to the cross of Christ. And all our hopes, we set on the risen Christ. Receive God's blessing as you leave. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and remain among you always. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
rejoicing in the power of the Spirit.
Thanks be to God. Amen.